Good evening and welcome to the regularly scheduled August 18th meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. The first thing this evening will be the minutes. Do we have any comments on the minutes as presented?
Madam Chair?
Yes.
It's a minor issue, but if I can find them, I think on page 2, top of the page, because this is the record, I think the vote should be, it should state how many favoring votes there are. It simply states that there's one opposed, one abstention.
That's a good point. Is there any particular...
So I guess we look back at how many voters there were. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Well, we don't know.
As I remember, it said 4 in favor.
4, 1 and 1.
And 1 abstention, and I didn't think it added up right. Does that add up right?
No, it doesn't.
Do we need to note for the record who was opposed and who abstained?
No, but I do just should state that...
That what the vote?
There was more than one vote in favor.
All right. Why don't we move to 3, 1, and 1?
I would say if you want the record to reflect who opposed and who abstained, you can. I don't care.
I think you should just show the number.
I have no problem putting my name in there. Janet, you were opposed? No. I can't remember who abstained. I abstained. Who opposed? Do you remember?
Tom Emery opposed.
No, I don't think so, because Tom Emery arrived after old business.
That's right. Okay. Why don't we leave it like that, so because we can't remember. We'll just let it ride at 3, 1, and 1.
That's all I had for comments.
That's good. I had to come in and it read differently, not having Alice. You supply us with a little more details, which kind of makes it easier for me to remember. There being no further comment, do I have a motion to approve them as read?
So moved.
I second.
All those in favor, signify raising right hand. All those opposed. Correspondence. We have a letter from the DEP thanking us on the wonderful job we did on our shoreline zoning. Okay. Got an A in that one. And the letter from the Conservation Commission regarding sidewalks. I called Jack the night I got this and told him that I would try to make sure that he is included and his group is included on any sidewalks that we have. Either through Maureen or myself, I'll try to remember to call him and invite him. He always has good input. I also had, I don't see it listed here, a letter from, what? It's a very old letter. We all know about it then? Okay. Then I'll put it away. First item tonight under old business is Stonegate Phase 4. And we're a little shorthanded tonight. I'm going to appoint Judy Larder as a voting member, I would say, for the rest of the evening, unless Tom shows up. Do we have anyone here from the Stonegate group? No. All right. I will be Stonegate for a moment. We have a request, a letter from Paul Bolger, who represents Stonegate. I will read it. Dear Maureen, I'm writing to formally request the application of CMS, Inc. for final subdivision approval for Stonegate Phase 4 be tabled until the September meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. This request is necessitated by delays in processing of the application for bond for road improvements. Kindly communicate our request to the Planning Board. CMS, Inc. will provide its proof of financial capability and bond required for final approval in time for the September agenda. Are there any comments from the Board? No? Do I have a motion in which case?
So moved.
Okay.
A second.
We have an order. Yes.
I beg your pardon. I have a motion for the Board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the request of the applicant, the application of CMS Construction for final subdivision approval of Stonegate Phase 4, a 17-lot subdivision located off Stonegate and Greystone Roads, be tabled to the regular September 1992 meeting of the Planning Board with the mutual consent of the applicant.
I'll second that one also.
Any further comment? All those in favor, raise your right hands. All those opposed? That's right. Okay. I would like to bring something before the board. I would like the request the board to allow us to suspend our rules this evening to allow a piece of new business in place of the old business. George Marcus is here requesting a public access waiver. This would technically be after the Rams Head subdivision discussion, which is under old business. If we move it around, I think that it would facilitate the not only Mr. Marcus is getting home quickly, but I could get home as well because I can't discuss Rams Head. So with that in mind, and I have a sick child, so do we have any discussion?
I have no objection to the suspension of the rules in this case.
Thank you. Any further?
All set.
Do we have to vote on that? No, they're suspended. Mr. Marcus, why don't you come up and tell us about what you're up to here?
Let me apologize at the beginning by saying I'm not terribly familiar with the procedures before the board. I've asked Teo Holtwick, who is the land use designer that I retained to assist me with this, to join me this evening, and he has agreed to do that. And he should be here within 5 minutes. But I will start and answer the easy questions, and if you have any harder questions, Mr. Holtwick will be here to answer those. I don't know, but I would hope that you have a copy of the plan or division of property on Fregosa Way.
Mm-hmm.
I purchased the property, I purchased the front 2 acres upon which I built a home in 1987. A year later, 1988, I purchased the remaining parcel of this land. The intention of the developer was to put 3 homes on this property, and I decided to make the purchase in order to control the way and manner in which the property was divided more to my satisfaction. Hopefully more of the neighbor's satisfaction. It has always been my intention, and I think it was the developer's intention, that there be more than one home on that site. Recently, I retained Mr. Holtwick and asked him to pair a division of the property that would accomplish a couple of objectives. One was to pair it in a way that would satisfy the requirements of the board. The other was to prepare it in a way that would provide for a suitable lot for someone to build a home upon, and thirdly was to do it in a way that would be sensitive to the concerns of our neighbors. Mr. Holtwick, I think, did a fine job with that. I'm going to turn the podium over to him in about 2 seconds, but what we tried to do is to develop a lot and a building envelope that would provide an appropriate site for a home, and at the same time would have sufficient setbacks and privacy considerations so as to minimize the impact upon the neighborhood. And I think we've accomplished that. With your permission, I'd like to have Mr. Holtwick address you further, since I'm really doing his job.
Sure. Thank you.
Okay, well, you go ahead.
I apologize for
no,
being late.
No, you're not late. We've
okay.
Taken things out of order right. In order to
okay.
have things go as smoothly as you'd like them right now.
I certainly appreciate it. The applications for a public access waiver, so in addition to what George Marcus was saying with regard to our efforts to determine an appropriate building window, we looked very hard at the driveway and at the existing driveway to see whether it would be suitable to accommodate the additional traffic and service needs for that second building window. It's a paved driveway, it's 15 feet wide. It is for the first 50 feet steeper than you would like to see it per your ordinance. So that's something that we ask a waiver of. We have reviewed this application with the fire chief to see if he had any particular problems with those driveway standards. But we feel because it's a paved driveway and in a very good condition, and I enclosed some photographs in the application, so you had some ideas to judge that for yourself. We respectfully ask a waiver of those conditions where it does not meet your exact standards.
Okay.
Because we feel that there's no additional impact really on. I'll be happy to entertain any specific questions you may have.
Thank you. Do we have any comments from the board?
I have some questions.
Go ahead.
Was this part of the original subdivision of, in this area, Salt Spray? I guess it would be part of Broad Acres or Hunts Point Road or one of those subdivisions.
This land is not part of the original Brockville subdivision. Brockville was developed around the property.
Mr. Marcus, could you step to the podium? And that's because there really are people who really like to watch this on TV, and that's how they hear what you're saying.
I'm sure there are. This land, the 6 acres in question, including the 2 acres that I have a home on and the other 4 acres, were not part of the original Broad Cove subdivision. In fact, they are not now in the Broad Cove subdivision, technically speaking. The land is surrounded by Broad Cove, but is not part of the subdivision.
Was the right-of-way that I see on the tax map part of the original subdivision?
In the original subdivision, there was a right-of-way reserved for this 6-acre parcel. It ran across land of Mr. Cummings. As originally reserved, it was a right-of-way. I purchased that right-of-way from Mr. Cummings so that I now own that 25-foot strip.
I have another question since I guess I'm on my mic's on, so to speak. I see on Teo's sketch here a reference to a pond. Has there been any investigation of wetlands in the area, or is there any implication of the setback from that pond to meet the shoreline setback requirements that might be related to the pond?
Okay, 1, 2.
The pond measures less than 1 acre in size, the pond and the associated wetlands. There are no specific setback requirements other than no construction could take place within those wetland areas. We have made a determination that the pond is less than 1 acre. We had that confirmed by the code enforcement officer. We have not done a specific wetlands mapping to see whether or not you would have, and that would be about 15,000 square feet of additional wetland area. On visual inspection, it is not the case because the edges of the pond are, the embankments are relatively steep, the wetlands associated are well contained within those boundaries. The proposed building window, we have chosen to keep a minimum of, I would say, 40 to 50 feet from the edges of the pond, and we certainly would not want to see any wetlands impact associated with this proposal. So, to answer your question in short, there is no, because the pond is less than an acre in size, there are no setback restrictions at that pond.
Okay. The reason I'm raising the questions, my first consideration was whether this was an additional subdivision to the original subdivision. Evidently, that doesn't seem to be the case. I have a personal dislike for what I call backlot subdivisions that stems from a lot of development that happened in Portland during the 80s when people buy lots, they assume that they've got a lot and the land behind them is either dedicated open space or something, and they find out that 10 years later someone's putting in a condominium project. This certainly isn't of that scale, but I was getting to that issue, and evidently that's not an issue in this case. The other item or question I had was in reference to the radii that you say pavement radius at Channelview Road intersection is proposed to be 25 feet. Is that the driveway radius or the property line radius? And if it is the driveway radius, why would you want one that large?
That's per your standards in the ordinance.
For a single driveway?
Well, really, and what we're talking about, we are in reality, we're talking a driveway. What we are talking about in the ordinance is a requirement for that kind of a radius, and I believe it's simply to accommodate fire trucks to make that turn if they so need to do that. That 25 feet, by the way, is what the existing conditions are, as much as I could approximate from the pavement. And
that's for the new driveway. Off the existing driveway, the shaded area on your sketch? That's
right. What you see on your sketch, that the only new construction would be the shaded portion of that sketch.
Okay.
The driveway that's labeled Rugosa Wave is existing. Where I've shown R for radius, we're proposing a 25-foot minimum radius.
Okay.
That's, again, per the fire chief.
Well, we're working on our street standards.
Yeah.
I driveway is a driveway and a street is a street when it's serving. There is no intention of any further subdivisions on either parcels. That correct?
That's correct.
Okay, thank you. That's all the questions I have.
Judy Lardner?
This perhaps might be a question to Maureen. I know when we did, I think it was the sleeper estate public access waiver, the one on the coast. We had a lot of public input. Was there a public hearing, or we just had a lot of people submit comments on that?
Anytime a new item goes to the planning board, a notice is sent out to abutters notifying that the planning board will begin to undergo review of a particular project. And the sleeper case, there were a lot of extremely interested neighbors who received the initial notice or did not receive a notice and had requested that there be a public hearing. And in that case, the board had exercised an option for a public hearing.
Did notices go out to all the abutters we see on this plan?
Yes.
Have you heard from any of them?
No.
Okay, thank you.
Any other comments?
Steve, did you want to?
No, go ahead.
I did neglect to bring up one item that I had marked down. Utilities. What are you proposing for utilities to this site?
Currently, lot 1 has an underground electric service that will be extended to serve lot 2. The water service that services lot 1 that is proposed to be extended to service lot 2, lot number 2 in terms of sewage disposal is proposed to have a on-site septic system.
Lot 2, has that been reviewed by the code enforcement officer?
There has been no application for a building permit made, so that's the next step that we plan to undertake in this process. Since it's not part of the public ways access waiver application.
Madam Chair,
Mr. Edsel,
just one and a half questions. And I think Mr. Marcus can probably clarify it. I just from recollection, there was an issue at the time of the Highlands at Broad Cove in reference to a right-of-way associated with that parcel and with your parcel of land. I can't recollect quickly enough what that issue was. Could you just how does that affect this parcel of land? And the other half of the question goes through Maureen. Is showing right title and interest a requirement of this submission?
Yes, I'll go first.
Yeah.
Yes, you have to show right title and interest. My assumption is that because the applicant has showed us right title and interest through the assessor's charts, typically the way we get that proven to us is through a survey. That hasn't been submitted.
Right.
We have surveyed, not really a survey, but a survey-like type work done by Mr. Holtwork, plus we have the assessor's records that back up that Mr. Marcus owns the property.
Okay. Steve, to answer your question, this piece of property came with about 25 rights of way all over Broad Cove. One of those is a right-of-way that goes out the back of the lot to Two Lights Road. The developer of the Highlands doesn't think it exists. I think it does. It probably isn't terribly material to what's happening here. I don't really envision anybody using that right away for anything, but I think that answers your question.
Yeah, I was just trying to remember, and I guess that was the issue, that you felt that you did have a right of way across the Highlands property, and right. I don't remember it ever being resolved.
No, it's never been resolved. The developer has chosen to ignore it. I've chosen not to make an issue of it. It's whatever it is, just sitting there.
Okay. Maureen?
That particular right-of-way is shown on the recording plat for the Highlands. It tends to run through along property lines of different lots, and it is shown on the plan in a particular location. I think the debate was that it didn't have to be depicted in a particular place, that there was more right rather than an actual location to it, but I think the Highland subdivision plan does show something to that effect.
Mm-hmm. Okay. No, I'm quite satisfied. The explanation and numbers 1 through 7 are quite clear. I'm familiar with the site somewhat.
I'm also familiar with the site. I've been up there without snow tires on snowy days, and even though the grade's a little steep, I don't have any problem with it. I think it's a very nice application. I congratulate you on that. And it's going to be lovely. In which case, do we have any motion from the board? We have no further discussion.
Madam Chair, I have a motion for the board to consider. Findings of fact, number one, George Marcus is proposing to create a second lot out of lot U3823, which will not have frontage on an accepted town road. Number two, public access waiver is required under Section 19-4-2B prior to the issuance of a building permit. Number three, the design of the access to lot two must be maintained by future owners of the lot to remain in compliance with the public access waiver. Number four, public access waiver request substantially complies with the intent of Section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of George Marcus for public access waiver for lot U3823 in the area of Ragosa Way and Channel View Road be approved in compliance with Section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance, subject to the following condition: that the requirements and design of the public access waiver be appended to the deed for lot 2 and recorded.
For the second?
Second.
Any further discussion?
Just one question. Who's responsible for maintaining Ragosa Way or road? Ragosa Way.
It's a private road.
Yours truly.
Okay, thank you. No other questions.
There being no further comment, all those in favor of the motion as read, raise their right hands. Opposed? None. It passes unanimously. And that's it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. The next order of business, let me just a moment. Do we need to sign that plan? Did? Mm-hmm. Okay. I didn't know if that was going to come up. I don't even know which one it is. In which case, I must excuse myself from discussion of Ram's Head, and I will turn the chairmanship over to Ms. McKay. And I bid you all good evening. Thank you.
Good evening, Mr. Hare. We're here for the Ram's Head subdivision request by Shaw Sprague for minor subdivision review, a wetlands alteration permit, and public access waivers of Ram's Head, a four-lot subdivision located south of Ram Island Farm. Lot R6-49 under Section 16-2-3A, 19-3-9-3, and 19-4-2B. Kind sir.
Thank you for switching us, first of all. Appreciated that.
We're glad to oblige for things that can be accomplished so expeditiously.
Okay. Well, since our last meeting, I received Maureen's memorandum of the 18th listing some summaries of issues raised at the last meeting, and I'd like to just go over some of the facts that we have revised the plans accordingly on items 1, 2, 4, 5, and 6, and give them to Maureen last Friday, and also fax it to the town engineer for his review. The street design we have revised and included more radii dimensions that he requested in specific areas that he requested. The streets have been named and placed on the recording plat. The lot coverage note, I just want to make sure that had been added on the last time regarding maximum of 20% impervious surface coverage. And also I put on there for clarification the fact that lot 3 as designed already has 10.5, existing conditions already 10.5% within the shoreline zone. So those people will know that they're already halfway to their coverage allowance. The fire chief comments, I've talked with him regarding the sprinkling of the subdivision. He said specifically for the subdivision, the fire chief recommends that any new structures be sprinkled. We'll be glad to comply with that and place that on the recording plat at all. Matter of fact, I have placed a note on the recording plat that all future structures built for residential habitation will be sprinkled. And if you know anybody would like us to revise that note further, be happy to comply with that. Other than that, I stopped by my office on the way here and saw that Shaw had got his performance guarantee to Maureen. I think it probably was yesterday, Maureen. I know that I gave you the cost estimate on Friday, but you have received Shaw's written. Okay. I realize that all those were received, late last week, so I don't anticipate that all the board members have reviewed the plans. But I just wanted to say that every item except item 3 was addressed in the memorandum. Now, Rick tells me that there was another issue raised either yesterday or today regarding the dead-end street issue. Is that true? I mean, it's the first I've heard about it, so.
Would the town planner like to advise us?
I would like to let board members know that I have received several items. The letter that you received this evening, dated August 12th, from Mr. Chenet, a transmittal from Mr. Hare, dated August 17th. I believe that's the performance guarantee, plus additional information at the end of last week. I'd like to suggest that these items I was not able to get them to the board with the regular package, and I would request and recommend they not be considered at this meeting, to give staff time to review them and also to give the board time to review them. The other issue Mr. Hare has raised is something that staff has come up with in terms of a concern we have, that this particular subdivision does not comply with the dead-end road standard that was recently adopted by the town. If you're familiar with that one, in section, I think it's 16.32A9, it limits the maximum width of dead-end roads to 2,000 feet in length. And the road is measured from the point that the dead-end condition begins to exist. My understanding is that would apply to this subdivision, that the dead-end road would begin where Charles Jordan Road, where Fowler Road begins from Route 77. From that point, there's only one way into that part of town. This standard does not allow additional houses to be added on through subdivision review to basically continue that dead-end standard. The other thing about that standard, if the board remembers, is it specifically says that the board cannot waive that standard. The one other thing I would like to let the board know is that since receipt of the letter you have this evening from Mr. Chenet, the town attorney will be preparing a letter in response to that will be available prior to next month's board meeting.
Ms. Lardner?
I have a question on the road standards. I actually thought about that a month ago or something, and the reason I thought it might not have applied, one, I assumed it would have been caught if it had applied to this project. And I also remember when we were having the public hearings, there were a resident perhaps from Hannaford Cove Road who specifically asked if it would affect existing roads, and he was told that the standard would not affect the existing road. And I'm kind of concerned, I can't believe it's the town council's intent that this land cannot be developed. So I'm curious if there, if there's not some way around this, because there are probably any number of existing roads that are longer than 2,000 square feet, that in essence means no one can put a single house anywhere on them.
I originally was unsure whether this applied to this subdivision for that reason, and because there were some private roads involved. In talking with the town manager, it's his feeling that the whole basis for that standard was for public safety reasons, and that this, there is no exception for this particular subdivision. In talking with Mr. Cheney this afternoon, the one issue we did discuss is that if someone were to add a single lot onto a dead-end road, it would not generate subdivision review. And because the dead-end road standard is in the subdivision ordinance, you would be able to incrementally add lots onto a dead-end road, but an entire subdivision wouldn't be allowed to do that.
Is there any sense that the town council would take this up as an issue to clarify?
I've frankly recommended to Mr. Cheney that that would be the route that he may want to take. Because the ordinance specifically says the planning board cannot waive that standard. It doesn't mention anything about the council. And I do remember in the development of that particular section of the ordinance that there was discussion about deferring that kind of waiver to the council. It's actually not unusual for example, with major subdivisions, developers are responsible to go to the council prior to coming back to the planning board for final subdivision approval to allow the council to conditionally approve streets because they are eventually going to be public facilities. So it's actually not that unusual to defer some of those street decisions to the council.
Can the board go forward at all if we're told that this subdivision can't take place right now?
I don't see any way around the standard. It's not something that can be waived by the board. I haven't been presented with any other way of interpreting it.
Maureen, I want to be sure that I heard you clearly. Is Jordan Road not a public road?
No, Charles Jordan Road is a public road.
It is a public road.
I was under the misconception that because the subdivision had private roads in it, that the private roads wouldn't be subject to this standard. But I don't find anything in the ordinance language that exempts private roads from public roads. It's just streets, period. So whether it's a private road or a public road, the problem is that there's a huge distance between any other way to get out to that area of town.
Maureen, do we have any other situations other than this in Hampton Cove? How many other roads are
there? Similar? Are a lot of other roads in town that are under the same situation.
Well, indeed, the last application before us, in essence, falls under this situation, except that it was not a subdivision application.
Exactly. Exactly.
I guess my interpretation would be that Charles E. Jordan Road is a public road, and therefore whatever distance from that public road into the site, if it doesn't exceed 2,000 feet, meets the standard. But obviously there's still only one way out, but you can take the interstate system, you can take U.S. Route 1, and at some point it's a dead-end road. But it still remains a public road.
Mr. Edsel?
It sort of caught me off guard because I was not aware of this, but I do remember very well when the ordinance was changed and the issue of the history of the planning board waiving that part of the ordinance in the past was a real sore spot, and I would hate to just step off on the wrong foot here with the new ordinance without going back to the town council on that. And I just want to make sure that that's the right path for the applicant, is to return to the town council. Is that correct, Maureen?
I think that's the most. That's the only other alternative I can think of. I'm certainly open to other suggestions, but it seems to me the most expeditious way would be to go to the council to either allow them to waive that standard or to allow them to amend the ordinance.
Just for those who weren't on the board, the objection or the comments dealing with the planning board waiving that or part of the ordinance in the past was not specifically from town council. It was from the police department, fire department, quite aggravated with the planning board on that issue. And so I think, and certainly like to hear from the applicant, perhaps we guide them back to the town council, give them our final recommendations from any comments. I will just make a comment on the letter that was presented by Mr. Chenet. I only got to the top of page 3 before we started tonight, so I don't, I didn't have a chance to really digest everything that was written in that letter either. Nor have I seen the performance guarantee.
And you, Mr. Edsel, you understand that the town attorney will be responding to Mr. Chenet's
Being one that held a fairly strong opinion about that last month and this month also, I think I'd like to hear what the town attorney has to say.
Well, Mr. Hare, it's certainly a peculiar development tonight. Do either you or Mr. Chenet care to comment further?
Well,
excuse me, before sure. I go further, I should do something that I neglected to do earlier, and that is, in light of the sparsity of members this evening, Ms. Lardner, would you be willing to serve as a voting member on this issue? Thank you. Mr. Hare?
Yeah, I guess it's a very surprising development, you know, looking at the ordinance and you know, in reference to the comment regarding somebody coming up early on the process and asking this specific question regarding, you know, development down in Hanniford Cove and getting the answer that no, this doesn't apply to existing roads, you know, existing prior to this amendment of the zoning ordinance. You know, that was, of course, it was our stance to take it from the end of the Charles E. Jordan Road and not extend it more than 2,000 feet. You know, not create hazardous traffic situations and develop a private way to the town standard. I mean, how else is anybody off the entire Fowler Road and Charles E. Jordan Road going to develop anything? And you know, there's you know, tens of roads in Cape Elizabeth like that. And just it's very surprising. That's all I can say. That we would even have to go to town council and get this decision decided, but if that's the only option.
Well, I certainly didn't know about it before today either, and I can tell you that this is not the first time that people on the planning board have commented that perhaps the Cape Elizabeth ordinance is not a model of clarity in a number of ways, but I always hate to see it, I always hate to see that structure exposed in a way that inures to the detriment of a particular applicant, and I certainly do understand that this surprise at a fairly late date in the proceedings is not desirable either from your standpoint or, frankly, from our standpoint either. Mr. Chenet, do you have anything to add to the deliberations tonight?
Rick Chenet, counsel to the applicant. I had a lot more to add, but Maureen took the wind out of my sails. Obviously, we're frustrated with this. Entire board, two professionals here, one professional on staff. 3 hours before the meeting, I'm told we have a problem that effectively kills this subdivision. I'm sure you can appreciate Shaw Sprague's disappointment with that. He would have been here tonight, but he couldn't make it this time. I haven't had a chance to take a look, close enough look at the ordinance to figure out whether I can come up with an interpretation that might lead you to conclude that this is not a problem. I haven't been particularly successful so far at convincing you of other interpretations, so I don't know if I'd be successful at that. But
Mr. Chenet, I'm sure you won't give up.
Well, I won't. There's nothing in the ordinance that seems to spell out the process for suspending, if that's the right way, suspending this process to allow us to go to the council. It doesn't say in there whether the council can waive that, whether it requires a text amendment. I don't know what. So I'm looking for some guidance along those lines. And I guess I'd like, if the sentiment of the board is mine and Charles Sprague's and Brad's, which this is sort of a little ridiculous under these circumstances that we would have to treat Charles Jordan Road as a dead-end road for some 2.5 miles, that maybe the board would be willing to make a recommendation in support of any request that we make to the council that this be waived as to this project. I mean, it's certainly not unique to Cape Elizabeth. I don't know whether you make recommendations along those lines under those circumstances. I had hoped, beyond that problem, to try to narrow down the remaining outstanding issues on this project. It's not entirely clear to me whether the list of issues in Maureen's prior memo have all been addressed. We know there's still an issue on the public access open space problems, and my letter is simply an attempt to try to put down in better language and clearer to you and to your council what our position on that is. And I don't want to get into that again tonight, except to simply say that we feel as strongly our way as you folks do your way. And I think that we ought to be able to reach some resolution that will resolve those problems without us having to battle over that any further. So I don't know what else to say on this dead-end street issue.
Maureen, may I ask a question? If this property were to remain in single ownership as a condominium and there were four condominium units on here, would that still go under subdivision? Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yes, it would.
Is there any other standard in the ordinance, such as cul-de-sacs or cul-de-sacs or turnouts located at certain intervals that would allow relief from consideration of a dead-end street?
That section is pretty tight. It was intended. I'm not sure that all the board members here. I was not here when that whole debate started either. My understanding is that there was a recommendation from the board to extend the length that a dead-end road could be constructed, because there was conflict on whether the board could in fact waive the standard, and the board had waived the standard. Certain staff members, basically public safety personnel, were very upset. The board made a recommendation to the council, which was unanimously not endorsed by staff. And then it was turned back to staff to come up with a new recommendation, which the council then adopted. So there definitely is two different approaches to this particular issue.
may I ask another question?
Certainly.
In terms of fire protection for the residential units, that to me has a lot to do with the safety issue. What is? Are these to be year-round residences?
We're assuming that they're going to be.
I remember what you said the last one. We're going to just basically assume, the most use scenario, and that'd be year-round. And like I told the new fire chief, sprinkle all the new structures.
But with a dry system, or I guess the issue is really public safety. It has nothing if the buildings burn and nobody's there during the winter. It takes the fire department long to get there. But the real issue is public safety. So assuming someone's there and the house is,
it would be a water drop down head sprinkled pressurized system. Simple terms, they're an oil tank put in your basement, mm-hmm. and they're fed with a pressurized line. And then when the fire kicks off, the heads drop down out of the ceilings. They're hidden up to that point, and they can put out a severe fire, from what I'm told, within 10 minutes.
Would that system be active if the house were unoccupied and unheated?
Yes, I believe that they're fail-safe that way, year-round use.
Okay. I don't know. Do we have any other residential development in town that's been required to put in a sprinkler system? Private individual homes?
I'm not aware of it there, although I can imagine that there have to be other places in town that are going to be under the same situation as this. There are, as I remember, some developments in the very southern part of Cape Elizabeth that still don't have year-round water.
One question.
Mr. Parkhurst?
Can they sell off one lot any intervals of time and not run into the same problem?
Mr. Cheney did talk to me this afternoon about what they could do if they chose not to proceed with subdivision review. If they were to go forward say, with one lot, that would not generate subdivision review. The board would be required to review a public access waiver request. If you remember the public access waiver standards, the board has two routes they can go. They can either go and require an applicant to follow the subdivision standards, which you usually do not do, or you could go with the second set of standards, which is the ones you usually do use. If you went with the first set, the subdivision standards, conceivably you could pull in the whole dead-end road standard all over again. However, if you went with the other route, it would just be a public access waiver because they don't have frontage on an accepted town road, and it wouldn't generate the subdivision review, wouldn't generate the dead-end road standard requirement.
Thank you.
Fortunately, George Marcus went before us tonight and not after us, because otherwise any new homes in Broad Cove would presume we have the same problem if you took that strict an interpretation. Can we, I appreciate the dead-end street issue as a stumbling block, but I would like to at least get some sense tonight what the remaining issues are for the board, other than that, and obviously the substance of my letter. Are there any other? The sprinkling is unusual at best. I don't think it's required under the BOCA code for residences, but Shaw doesn't have a problem with that. We're happy to do it. We just assume you're not required. If you don't want to require it, great. But he'll do it if the board feels strongly about it. Are there any other issues that the board feels need to be, that haven't been addressed in one fashion or another?
Anybody like to address any other issues? Mr. Parkhurst?
Well, is this truly the appropriate time to do this until the other issue is resolved?
Well, if there are issues that are of major concern, it may very well mean that we won't proceed. So I can't advise Shaw what to do now if I don't have some sense as to what stumbling blocks there are.
You're referring to issues beyond those addressed in your letter.
Yeah, I guess maybe going back to Maureen's memo from the previous meeting and just going down the list and seeing if there are any other issues that you feel we have left unresolved. One of the reasons I tried to shift the agenda around tonight is I anticipated we'd be here a while, and I hope to have a good discussion about some of the issues. And,
Maureen, would you like to respond to Mr. Schnee?
Hopefully to clarify, I think what his question is in the memo that I wrote, I attempted to summarize any issues that I thought were still outstanding. Obviously, I didn't include the dead-end road standard. I think what he's asking is, is there anything that the board needs to add to this list? Because I believe that if with the information that he's submitted, which still needs to be reviewed, if it's all up in line, the only remaining issues would be number 3 and the dead-end road standard. And I think his question is there anything else?
Just a question to you, Maureen. The performance guarantee that you have, I know it hasn't been completely reviewed, but I assume that's something that can be worked out. It's not something we really have to cite as an issue now?
Right. They have submitted an estimate of the guarantee, and they have submitted an actual format for the guarantee. So at this point, we need to review the estimate, and that's certainly something that we adjust on a regular basis. I don't see that as having to be an issue unless the applicant would be unhappy with any adjustments that the town engineer felt were necessary. The other thing was we would have our town attorney and the town manager review the language of the performance guarantee, and typically, again, that's a pretty technical piece of work, and we ask for certain revisions that usually are not an issue.
Okay. So the prior memo and your list of issues, what's left is in your memo, and it's the big issue of public access, open space, and the dead-end street issue. Okay.
That's the way that I understand it. I just wanted to make sure there is no further issue with respect to the fire chief and the hydrant, because you have agreed to sprinkle the individual.
If the board wants us to sprinkle the two new homes, we will do it. It's not it's odd, but I think it can be tastefully done, and we hope it won't be an issue for anybody buying a home. I mean, it is a it's a safety issue, obviously. I might be concerned if I live that far away from. So we'll do it. We've talked to Sean. He doesn't have a problem with it. And I think we were going to, weren't we going to do a dry hydrant, Brad?
We're going to put a dry hydrant in the pond. And
That's already on the plan. The dry hydrant is on the plan.
And so this note in your memorandum, Maureen, that says that Fire Chief recommends that any further development in the area include extension of the water line means any further development over and above what's contemplated at the present time.
Exactly.
Okay.
If the board wants to vote not to impose the sprinkler condition, we'd be happy
to. Mr. Chenet, you've suggested it several times.
Sorry.
Mr. Emery?
Well, I just have a question as to whether is that an issue that the board has sort of discretionary powers over? That to me seems very much a building code and a fire chief issue. I find it quite extraordinary in light of all the fact that it seems to me there are bigger issues, the saleability of the property, the insurance coverage on the property, that those things and the buyer's preference would deal with that issue.
I think the issue the fire chief was trying to get at is that we had at least a half hour conversation about that. He has very serious concerns that there's adequate water out there to fight a fire, period. However, this project is already in the works, and he can see that there would not be any desire on the part of the applicant to extend the water line at this time. So he's compromising and saying, at the very least, please put sprinklers in the building. I can say in the past I've seen this kind of requirement when there have been concerns about ability to fight fires. If there aren't enough fire lanes around the building, sometimes that's requested. If the building has a lot of units, that a fire chief may feel that his particular fire department may be unused to having to fight that many fires, they will ask for sprinklers. So he feels very strongly about this, and based on my conversation with him, it seems to me a very reasonable thing for the board to require, as opposed to requiring a water line to be extended to that point.
I agree.
Mr. Emery? I'm sorry, Mr. Edsel.
I was quickly looking at the Highlands, because the sprinkling issue came up at that subdivision also, and it's not a part of this plan. But that was an issue, I think, because of the size of the water main and the pressure and so forth. And I don't see that as a part of this. So it's not necessarily unprecedented that we talk about sprinkling residential dwellings in certain subdivisions. I think if the fire chief feels strongly about it, then we should heed his request.
Just to add on the Highlands, I believe that eventually that was resolved through the developer installing a new water line.
A new loop, I believe. There was an additional loop put in the water line to maintain pressure.
Would the board be willing to, rather than have this be a mandatory condition, simply require us to put a note that it's recommended, given the proximity of the houses to the fire department, that sprinkling be put in each unit, and then leave it up to the discretion of the individual home buyers whether or not they actually want to do it? I mean, if you're concerned about notifying people of what's going on.
No, I think the issue really is the fire chief's issue. That is, if there are people in the dwellings and he gets there and the dwellings are burned flat and there's four dead bodies that he's got to truck away, that's what he's concerned about. And rather than require that the applicant build a new water main, this is what he feels most comfortable doing. I feel comfortable supporting the fire chief's position
okay.
on that.
That's fine.
Ms. Lardner?
This is changing the subject, but the dry hydrant is new on the plans, is that correct? Maureen, just so it doesn't become an issue, since there would be, I assume, wetlands alterations involved where it is, and we might need profiles and plan views and this and that, can that all be worked out so that doesn't stop us when the engineer reviews it?
I guess my position would be, because it's in what we're calling a wetland protection zone, the applicant is already applying for a wetlands alteration permit, because they're putting driveways in the wetland protection zone. Because this is on the plans, this would automatically be included as part of the wetlands alteration permit.
But wouldn't we need, though, to see profiles or whatever work's being done?
There is a profile of the actual hydrant. I'd have to look at the plans to see if there's any. Are you looking for limits of construction activity?
I just want to make sure that when this goes to the engineer, that we don't get held up on this issue too, that whatever is needed for his review and okay on the hydrant, that's taken care of before we see it again.
Okay. The engineer had had your town engineer, the dry hydrant had been on the last submittal, so that I'm assuming that because he hasn't mentioned it on here, that he had no problems with our details and our positioning of it.
I just don't want you to get caught again on another detail.
Right. Thank you for taking the time. We've also notified the DEP through the permit by rule process that we're going to be impacting a little bit of wetland. But because we're taking out wetland material and putting it back in, it doesn't seem to be that much of an issue, but that will all be taken care of prior to that.
Anything further from the board? Anything further from Mr. Schley?
Only that, can I talk to Maureen on tomorrow or whatever to figure out how we deal with this dead-end street issue?
I would recommend that you each talk to the other, and I understand that Maureen will make herself available, and I know you'll make yourself available.
She's been superb at being available.
Do I hear a motion? Mr. Emery?
Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application Shaw Sprague for minor subdivision review, a wetlands alteration permit and public access waiver for Ram's Head, a four-lot subdivision located off Charles E. Jordan Road, be tabled to the regular September 15, 1992 meeting of the Planning Board with mutual consent of the applicant.
Second. Do I hear a second?
So moved. I second it.
Any discussion? All in favor of the motion? Unanimous? I take it, Mr. Schnee, we have the mutual consent of the applicant?
You have it.
Thank you.
How do you define mutual consent?
different. Mutual consent of the parties, I guess we should say. With the consent of the applicant, it should be.
Are we turned off now?
No.
Mr. Etzel.
Before we go into any further business, just for the public record, the rest of us know that Tim Eichenberg's last meeting was our last workshop, but I'd just like as one board member to say that I think he added a lot to this board. I learned a lot from him, and I'll miss him very much from this board.
Thank you for reminding me that I wanted to also say that we wish him well. He's moving out of state, and I also second the fact that I think I've learned a lot from him and that he's been a distinct addition, and I hope that we can get a substitute for Mr. Eichenberg, who is as good as he is and will carry on the tradition. So, anything else? Meeting is adjourned.
In regards to this letter prior to the next meeting, like our attorney's response.
You will have a letter from our attorney prior to the next meeting in your packet.